Hi, welcome to this Open Security Summit session on a very important topic in security, which is called distroless container. And it's one of the things that actually Timur presented sort of as a little side thing in one of the sessions last time. And I was like, ooh, we want to hear more about this because I think this is super important. So Timur Patel is here to, go through this and show us his experience. And I'm really looking forward because I think it's something that we really need to add to a lot of our containers, and it will make a massive difference in the attack surface and even the performance of those containers. So Timur, over to you.
Yes, thank you. A small remark in the start, one of my clients is SDASE, and I will show some examples from them, but I don't speak for SDASE, and also maybe at other points SDASE will do it different than what I show here. Okay, after this small disclaimer, we come to the agenda. I start with an introduction. Afterwards, I will introduce you into multi-stage builds. Then I will give you distroless examples and vulnerability analysis for these distroless images, because you can do it in different ways. Afterwards, we will quickly talk about JIP, and then we will come to a conclusion. For the introduction, I brought this study, the vulnerability funnel. So this is actually about applications and not about the container level, but I think this is very nice to see how important it is. Because when I talk with information security people and we are detecting vulnerabilities in applications, they say that needs to be handled within one day. And I try to convince them that one day might not be what we need, because there are just potential vulnerabilities which might not apply. So on the other hand, some apply. So let us see how it is for application dependencies. Here we see, I'm not sure why this is not 100%. Somehow they removed some dependencies from their statistic. So here we see that they find 97.4 open vulnerabilities. From this 97%, we have 52 only with a proof of concept. So all the other here, the difference, they are all not important for us. Then again, we have we reduce this number.
So Timur, just to clarify, these are vulnerabilities in containers?
No, applications. But this is the best graphic I could find to explain that not all vulnerabilities which will reach out to you are actually applying to you. So this is the other side of awareness, I think.
Okay,
cool. So normally you would start with why is this important and scare people. And as we are all security people or learning security, I thought I start with this one here to highlight the other side, how many of them actually apply to us.
Yeah.
From this 52%, we reduce the number again by around 25%, which are actually getting are exploitable. Really exploitable. And then we reduce this 25% again. So, or the study reduced it and said only 1% here is actually exploitable and executable, and there are exploit available so that you can see it out in the wild.
Yeah.
But the problem is that especially in applications, I do vulnerability scanning with OWASP dependency check. I perform this periodically every day and raise the issues to the developers. And there I see that, especially in the start, when you haven't had this maturity beforehand, you get vulnerabilities at least once in a week, mostly two times in a week, with severity high or critical. And then you get a lot of vulnerabilities during the year. So you will have some of these 1% here. So even if it's just a potential vulnerability, you should take it serious because it might apply to you. So these are the two sides, right? just the potential vulnerability, but on the other hand, as you have so many vulnerabilities, they do apply. As I said, I couldn't find such a nice statistic for packages and containers, but I'll show you another study. Just to make sure, that was the application level here. So we will not talk about the application level anymore. So we will come to the container security. That is where we are right now. Just to mention, when you perform cloud hardening, you could also talk about Kubernetes itself or the operating system. But we are today talking about this layer, container security, and how to enhance it. This is another study which has been performed. So this is more to really raise the awareness. They check different operating systems in container environments and counted the total amount of packages. So you see here that Debian Jesse has 106 packages, while Elpan is already reduced to only 13, 14 packages. You can also see here that they used two different scanning tools. One is Anchor and the other one is Clear. And based on these two tools, they identified the vulnerabilities inside and figured out how many of false positives, false negatives, and true positives. So that we see that are a lot of false positives here. That is the one I would like to highlight. So there are true positives. That means there are really vulnerabilities in the containers, which are, I'm not sure how when I go back on which state they are from this study, how deep they analyzed it, but we see that there are a lot of vulnerabilities. I also often, I'm not sure how exploitable they are because it's in the image. When I see the CVEs, it's very hard for me to read, is this actually applying to my container or not? So that is in other things we should question here. But sometimes I do recognize that they are matching to my container image, or at least I cannot say, is it applying or not? That is the most often happening. I cannot say, is it applying or not? Sad story, yeah. So they just matched containers. So that's what I said beforehand. I'm not sure where they are here. They are more on the, I would assume that they are around this level here and didn't go deeper. So there are might be still false positives, even they highlight it's not. So they're just matching the packages, I think. Okay, let us now set the baseline for the technology we are using. As we are now all aware that vulnerabilities might arise in our images and we need to do something. I'm personally not a fan of vulnerability scanning. There are other talks where I present my idea why it's not so useful to scan for vulnerabilities in packages. What I highlight in this talk is that we need to think about patch management. And for that, we will now understand the basic technology to then see how we can use distress images and why is this helping us with patch management. Attack surface reduction is what we had in the last call, how I called it. So building of images is basically you have a Docker file in which you say from, and then you define from which image you would like as a base image. Then you run a command like yum install Java. So we're installing Java, and then we copy the already builded app here. So this one is already lying on the file system and we are copying it just here in our image, and that is performed by the Docker build command. Then we have a technology called multi-stage build where you can actually perform the task of building this jar file here in an extra temporary layer. So you have, for example, a new Ubuntu image, here CentOS image. These are just examples. You can exchange this with your distribution of your choice. In this temporary image, you install Gradle, and then you build your jar file, the artifact you would like to have in your image. And in the image which you're using in the end, you don't need to install Gradle. You just install OpenJDK and use the given jar. And this both you can define in one go in one Docker file. So this is how it looks. So basically here you say you create a reference as build, then in this case I copy the app, the app, the code folder, and then I install here Gradle, OpenJDK. You might also use here on the top as a base image already OpenJDK or your Java of your choice. And then we build the jar. So this is a reference here, and this reference we can use in the next step where we create our runtime image. So here we have the base CentOS. We see we can have different ones, as I said. Then we perform yum install OpenJDK, and here we copy, and we have here the reference to the build. So from the build, we copy the app, which is under app build app jar, and copy it for us in the folder app build app jar. And then we have an entry point that we just execute Java and this jar. Obviously, you can also use a Tomcat, for example. That depends on how you want to start the application. Now we come to distroless, how distroless works. This is just one example. You can also use it in a different way, which we will discover afterwards. Here is, we are using CentOS 5. I'm using CentOS 5 here because we saw already on the slide before that there's already CentOS 8. So 5 is, I think, out of maintenance. But maybe you have a container in production, which has an old image. And later I will show some statistics. That's why I think we assume that we have a very old, bad image here. And CentOS 5 is used. So we create again the build here, the last, which is from 2017. We have the reference build, and then we create, and this time a Google, we use a Google distroless image as a base. And then, so that is already reduced. You can see it a bit like Alpine. And then we just copy the shell from the CentOS, because we say, okay, we would like to have a shell in our container. And the shell itself has a dependency to libtermcap. So we also need to copy libtermcap. So these are the only two things we get. We are not getting anything else. We are not having a package manager, for example, or other things.
So what's inside that distroless base Debian 10?
This is from Google here, and actually there is a package manager, a small one inside, but there is very 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 little inside in this distroless image.
How big is it?
Sorry.
How big is it?
Yeah, let us wait a second.
Okay, sorry.
And then I will show you the statistics, how big these different images are. I will also show you some other ways of doing it, which are better from the size perspective, but worse from other perspectives. That is what I would like to highlight within this talk. Here's another way of building it. This is actually the best one, I feel. This is how I create the cluster scanner. Which we have seen last Open Security Summit, and we will see it, I think, next Open Security Summit again. Here we create one more up. Here we have a base image, and I'm using here the Red Hat image, Universal Base Image 8. As tools. So with tools, I mean, there are tools which I need to create our target image, the runtime image. That is this one here. This is the image which we would like to get afterwards. So this is the one we will ship in production. Here we see that this is based on Scratch. So there is really closely nothing to inside. It has 4 kilobytes. I think that is mainly metadata which is in there. This is a very, there's nothing inside, right? So we have these two images. I'm using Builder here, so you might not be familiar with Builder. With Builder, you create shell scripts like you see here to build an image. And what I do here in the start is I create the, let's call it container here, based on the base image we defined here, this Red Hat one. You can use any other image you like as a base. We have here the mount. So this just is the access to the container itself. And this here is that we get access to the file system of the container with this builder mount here. So then we can afterwards copy, for example, files or use even execute the commands. Beforehand, we just copied, right? So now we would like to execute here things which will in the end go to here. That is the target. This is our target image. Again, we do the same thing. We have the container and the mount. Then I define some DNF options. DNF is a package manager within this universal base image from Red Hat. And then I use DNF here. There are some extra flags which I'm using, but they doesn't matter to understand the general idea. I use DNF from the container here. So within one container, I'm using DNF to install here things like bash or tar, jq, and so on into here. You see MNT, that is our target. So this here is mounted, and in the DNF options, we see that there is that the installation target is MNT, and this mount is mounted, so we install it in our target.
So just a quick one. So that builder, I didn't know about it. It's pretty cool. So I'm just looking at it. So that basically is a tool facilitates building open container initiative images. So that will create a Docker image, right?
Yeah, that is correct. It builder creates a Docker image. In the end, you can run. I don't know it in my head. Let me show you. I will try to make it bigger for you. In the end, there are some other metrics in here. But for the basic concept, in the end, you run builder config to create a config, and then we can run commit to create the image, and then we can push it.
So you use this instead of using Dockerfile, right?
Yeah, this is an alternative to Dockerfile. Yes.
What's the advantage? It looks cool, but what's the main advantage of doing that? So you can actually script it, right?
Yeah, I can script it. Yes, I can do more things in here. You can see here, for example, that I create a so-called bill of materials. So what is inside the container? I take into account all the files which are lying here in the repository itself, and that creates a bill of materials. So what I can now easily do is to check if there is a change. So I can perform this build as often as I like, for example, daily or every hour, in case you would like to have a high maturity. And then only when there is actually a change, then you push the image.
Cool.
Because when there is no change, why push, right? And actually, we are talking about displaced images. So here is a small remark I'm fetching here. The bill of material is going to the whole image, to the whole tools image, which I'm using. But in case you would like to spend some time, I'm sure you can create a bill of materials only for the files in the file system, like your user find or something. And then you only build it when there is a change.
So this is really cool. For, like you said, for Start to create really lightweight distributions and very, very customized distribution. This is really cool. And I'm assuming it's probably a bit faster, right?
Faster? Yeah, if they are smaller, you can pull them faster.
Okay. Very cool. All right, good stuff.
On the network, you save some traffic. The network layer. You don't need to do it like this one here. I also saw other implementations where the build server itself is on Fedora, and then you have DNF already installed, so you can save this here. So you just run wsappin DNF and install it directly, but that means that the image in which you're building needs to have DNF already. I, for example, I'm working on a Ubuntu system, and that means that I don't have DNF on my local computer. So that's why I thought I use Builder with these tools image here to actually install the dependencies into my target image. So this is here optional. The first thing here you can.
And then I was just looking at, so then Podman, you could use this with Podman to execute the container. Is that one way to do it?
You could use Podman locally, but to execute it, you can also use Docker. So you can, in the end, you push it, right? You push it to your registry, and then you can use it as a normal image.
Yeah, but one of the requests that we actually had was to run a very small Docker-like environment, right? But not Docker, like, because Docker was already a bit heavy. So could you use this and Podman to like build an image, and then you start it with Podman?
Or yeah, absolutely. Actually,
and that will be very small footprint, right?
Yes. Actually, Builder and Podman are going very closely together on your local. That is very often used together. Yeah.
So you could use Podman regardless of this, but just to execute the container. And yes. Now we'll have a very small footprint on the and memory consumption on a final computer, right? A device.
Yes. Correct.
Cool. Good stuff.
So as we already recognized, we have less network costs, and that means faster deployments. I already had a debate on what it actually means, because when you have a Java application, you have to also load Java application in memory, so you can't save that. But in the discussion, we weren't sure when you have an image with, for example, a shell, but you never use the shell, what it means for the deployment. So that was open in that discussion. So in the worst case, it only means that you're able to start it a bit faster. But we didn't come to a conclusion in that discussion. And then from the security point of view, this here is a main phase. You perform a reduction of the attack surface. From my point of view, what it does is, in case you have a container here, and in there you have the OS. So in case someone is able to compromise the container here, then it can't use so many tools here on the operating system to actually go to other containers. So that is, from my point of view, the main use case. It reduces the blast radius. So there are, you could argue that when you get, when you have a Java application here, and you take over the whole code of the application, then this reduction doesn't help so much. But from my point of view, as less an attacker has to go forward, as better it is. Because this less means, to be precise, in case you don't install this bash here, which is recommended. So this is an example from the cluster scanner. The cluster scanner uses bash, so there it is needed. But normally you don't install a bash, so you don't have a shell to communicate with the operating system. You just have the application itself. And that is, from my point of view, a big enhancement. Yeah, when we have less operating, less operating packages, we have less files on the file system, means less possible vulnerabilities.
It'll be interesting to then see the stats, right, of how much you actually reduce that, because I think that, you know, that's a massive win in this case, right? Because like you said, like the amount of stuff that gets sometimes shoved into a container or OS, right, that you don't need is enormous.
Yes. 3 years back, I performed a hardening of containers for client. So I did the user stuff, right? Like removing group ID or user ID files. Then I removed some other files. But this is the wrong way, right? I just remove things and there will definitely be there is stuff which is not needed. While here we only have what we need. Yeah. So this is a 3 years old one, 3 years old approach. And now we have, or maybe even 4 years, but now we have a better approach.
Yeah. Oh, you go into a good state, man. Like, you know, we go for what we want versus, you know, remove stuff that we don't want.
Yeah. I mean that is security theory, which everyone hears in master in his studies, right? But to apply it is more difficult. Here is a small remark, as you can see, because what we are not having is a package manager in the end. You can, someone of you already determine what it means when we don't have a package manager for security? What might be a desire, especially in compliance areas? A desire would be to scan here what packages are there and are there vulnerabilities for that available. But all these tools are going to the package manager and asking, what do you have? In case I can't ask, that means no vulnerabilities. Especially when you do it this way here. This is an example of how to do it in another way. I showed you the best example first. So now we come to a more complicated example, which I also used. So what we are doing here is we again have CentOS 5, and then in our very small image here from scratch, we are copying all the files which we actually need in our image to make it run. But this is very, as you can see, very complicated, because you'll be copying the tools here, which are needed to execute. Somewhere here must be a glibc. Here it is on the bottom. So there are that is, for example, the communication with the kernel. But what happens in case you get a patch and this is called SU.2, then this one here will fail. So you won't copy it. So this is, from my point of view, not the best approach, and it feels like a step back. Why is this here with you install this with DNF, and DNF recognize what is actually needed. You install here, for example, the core utils. So that is, from my point of view, the better approach. I haven't checked how much more this actually installs compared to this copy, but I think it will be much better than from a maintenance perspective. Here we copy, in addition, these are the operating components, and these are the files which we need. So in my case, I wanted to have a shell. So I need again this libterm cap as a dependency for the shell itself.
Just a question. Where do you get the mappings for those dependencies, right? Because if you're removing a lot of the stuff that those tools expect to be there, right?
where do you get the list of, for example, libs that you know, something needs?
Who again? I understand your question, but so who needs it? The container who's getting executed needs stuff.
No, where do you get the list, right? So,
that is the question. That is exactly the question. So what you could do is you go to these needed files, they're core util single, for example, or util Linux, that are, I think, one of the things you need. And then you take a look in what is getting installed in the packages, and then you copy. At one client, it actually broke, because this case here actually happened, and then the base images were broken. So because you don't recognize that it's not working afterwards, obviously, that the client installed, created a test in the build deployment of the base images to check that it's actually executable. So. That all the images which are building on top of the base images are still working, but that was a process that client had to went through. To create the list is hard. I would go through these packages here and figure out which files are in there, and then I create this list out of it.
So John was saying LDD, is that a tool that you can use?
Yeah, that would work. Yes, that could work.
But I guess, you know, we also want to maybe start to create these mappings in a public. It's almost like, again, a safe way, right? Like, you almost want to have a recipe that says, you know, if you start from scratch and you want to add CURL and you want to add Git or you want to add some other tools, right? What are the recommended extra bits that you need to add, right?
Yes. So why Git, for example, you don't need, right? In your runtime image, there is no Git needed.
Well, you might need to, right?
Yeah, when it's a dependency, yes, but then that is something you wouldn't perform on your base image. So from my point of view, you have two layers. You have the things here on the left is some kind your base image. And the things here on the right is your project image. So this is getting created, let's say, every hour. We saw already that we can create a build of materials, so it doesn't matter how often we do it. And then when this one here is recreated, then you automatically build the project image. In the best case, that is a vision. that I saw already at one client. But then to put this in production is mostly a manual step. So you have the left side with the base image, this you do automatically, and the right side is where you would also add Git, for example. That is for me only here. That is what is needed for the project, for the container to run. I will have a better picture later to make that more clear. Let me see if I find it quickly. So you have here the base image from the public repository. Then you somehow create the distroless image out of it, and from that you have maybe special images like Nginx and OpenJDK, and they are used for production. But then here on top you actually have the project layer.
Yeah, so that's the tree. That is that what exists, or is that what you created?
That's how it works from my point of view. The right side here, we will take a look at later. Forget just take a look at the left side. The right side, we will take a look later. What I mean with that, but the left side is how I see it at clients. Also the whole picture, but the right side I will explain afterwards.
But is that today, like, but those images are the ones you created, or are the ones that you can already be made available?
Yeah, the public registry, and this is all in the organization here.
So that CentOS Production 8 Nginx, that's actually the one that you created, or the organization created.
Yes, correctly. And then they are used by projects.
All right.
You could, for example, there are already distroless distributions which install a lot of the dependencies they think they are needed, like the Google distroless images. Then you don't need this step here on the ground. Then you will start with this one here. And they also provide a directory for Java, so then you would start directly here. But that depends on what is your base.
Cool. Makes sense.
You see, there's a lot of stuff to come. Yeah, so this is the statistic. I would like to start with this one here, the statistic. So this is only copying the files you need, nothing else. So this is scratch 4 kilobytes. As I said, I'm not sure what it is. There must be some kind of metadata in an image, which is always there. And then you have here the image I just showed with a copy of the files. And the shell in addition, that is 3.8 megabytes. And in total, we have 18 files.
That is really cool.
And now let us enhance this comparison for other possible options. What I also performed, I used Trivi to identify vulnerabilities in an image, just to give you an impression. CentOS 5 from 2017 has in total 546 images identified by Trivi. We have 0 critical, but 31 high vulnerabilities. You could perform this by yourself with this command. I also published the image. In case you don't trust me, you can do that. Right, I will, for this presentation, continue now, but you could also assess it by yourself. As I'm just copying files here, what I performed is a manual assessment going through all the packages behind all these files here and checking if there is a vulnerability open. I think that was in 2000. No, we have 21. That was end 2019 when I performed this analysis. So I matched with FEMSeek what files are there, and then afterward, to which packages these files belong to, and then I discovered what vulnerabilities are listed for that. And with this approach, we reduced already a lot, because now we have here we see we have NSS, for example, had 2 vulnerabilities, and the libstdc or the libgcc had 3 medium findings, for example, and some low findings. So beforehand, we saw we had here 31 findings. So we reduced this number a lot already. Let us assume you actually perform analysis of vulnerabilities in your production containers. That will take some time, right? Because you need to analyze every time there is an issue, a vulnerability raised. In case you would be able to perform this kind of thing for distress images, then you would see now you have reduced the number of analyzers already to 2 times from 31. Cool. It are maybe also the medium findings, and it would be much more in case you also take medium into account. It's 200 here, then you came down already a lot. Okay, now let us take a look at another approach which you might take into account when you say you don't want to perform all to create this copy or create your own base images. Then you could go to Google. Google actually invented these distroless images, and they created a distroless a version also publicly available, where they have, for example, here's this base Debian. And then I copy here for this distroless image only the needed file, again, libtermcap and binsh. And here, when we do that and compare again, we have in the base image itself, without any modification, we have 22 megabytes. We see there is already a big gap, right? This we want to be distressed and not have something we will be in addition. So here we see that there is some things in addition which we might not need. We have 1,222 files, but this is still better than using Debian by itself, right? I haven't perform the comparison, but there will be much more, I assume. And then we will have 24 megabytes when we also include the shell, which we copy. And that means we have two files more here.
Now, if this was like an Nginx, right? Or like a node or a Python.
No, nothing. Nothing inside. Here we only have a shell in addition. In node, I assume there are much more files, right?
Oh, so this is like 22 megabytes. It's like the smallest possible image you can have that is actually a Linux distribution.
No, the smallest version here is this. One example here is the 3.8. That is the smallest version. In Google Distroless, you will have some more files already. They claim it to be distroless. As you can see, there is already a difference here. So when you build it by yourself, you will follow the idea in a much broader way. But you also said, wouldn't it be nice to have a list of common things you normally need? So that are the things in here. So there will be something like maybe things you need for time management, for example, or they also have a version for Java. And then they already install some fonts for you. I think fonts and other things which are often needed when you have Java. So that is what they include already. That is what are the things you mostly need. Then they included, for example, for Java, I think it was fonts. I can't say it for sure or if it was something else. But they include things which developers normally need. So when you follow this approach here, after some time, developer will come and say, I need this, this, and this in addition. And then it will obviously blow up. Maybe not to 22 megabytes, but to something in between. So they have the what is commonly needed. So you're going more in the direction of a distribution. Here you have the overload of doing it by yourself. Okay, let us continue here. What I said already, when you perform vulnerability analysis, which you often see when you open your registry of your choice in your browser, they perform analysis. As it is on packages, when you do this copy, for example, this will definitely show you zero vulnerabilities, or it will say unknown in the better case, because they are based on the packages. And as there is no package manager, they can't fetch that. For when you use Google with their images, then they actually publish the vulnerabilities in there, so they will do the work for you. So that is what you have to take into account. As I said, from my point of view, in case you want to do vulnerability scanning, the baseline is that you have already a very, very good process for deployment. So that is a pre-requirement before you start with this, because in case you find a vulnerability and you need 2 weeks to deploy a patch, then it doesn't help to know that you have doesn't help so much that you know that you have a vulnerability when you can't push it fast. The fix. Okay. Again, a vulnerability-based assessment for Google for the base Debian image from Google. I haven't. So as I copied the app, there will be no outcome for the shell itself. We see that we have only one medium finding here, so that is already a reduction, no high or critical ones and some low ones. It's much better than what we saw first, right, in CentOS 5. So this is already better. This is a comparison again, how we reduce the number. So we see the attack surface is reduced a lot. That is the outcome which you should take away from this talk. As we have discovered already, Builder is a good option to create images, which I'm recommend to you. But as you have seen already, it means that you can't use your normal Docker files anymore. You will have this shell script, and that is not something you learn in 5 minutes. So it will take you some time. So maybe you do it in a way that you use base images, which you provide, and there you use your operations team to create them. So that are operators, and then for the project, you do it again, and that is performed with a builder. And for your project images, which are the developers, you are using Docker, so that would become some options you have to not have the need to distribute the knowledge on how to create images with Builder, because Docker files are very known to the developers, so they can still use it. You can use it this base image and just put your jar inside with Docker. That is possible. Well, we saw already this image inheritance tree, and as you have seen already, let me build it completely. Here on the left side, we have the production images. But with the production images, we are facing one problem. Sometimes, for whatever reasons, it shouldn't happen, as we all know, but it happens that a developer has a wish to debug in production. So what sometimes is performed is to open a shell. So maybe you have a temporary access to a container and open the shell. But as we are having here on the left side, this today's images, the shell is not possible. So, and also when you're in development and testing, you don't have that. And there I would say, why not have a shell? In case you need it, why not have a shell? So here you need a shell, for example, to perform debugging. So what is a possible option is to create development images which have a full distribution. So also a shell, a package manager, to install something ad hoc, and so on. And in case you are discovering you're facing problems while development or on the testing environment, you can easily switch to not use this base image, then you will use this. And in the worst case, also you are having the option to push for an analysis to use this here. Then you perform your analysis in production, and then you switch back to the distress image. So what that means is in the end, you need to have two different base images.
Do you have any stats on or experience when you do this at, with high volume of containers and the optimization, the reduction of speed, and even that scenario of saying that, we can run the pods, the lighter one, but then every now and then you flick the switch. But what's the kind of the performance advantages of this, in production?
What do you mean by performance advantage?
So for one of the projects we have is we create lots of pods. Like literally a lot of pods, right? So the performance for starting a pod makes a difference, right? Like, the size of a pod makes a difference on its performance, right?
I haven't performed deeper analysis regarding performance. But yeah. In case you figure something out, why don't you create a new Open Security Summit talk and present your results.
Sort of, we will.
Yeah, I can't say that. What I can say maybe is that, and we go back to the creation here. When you use Builder is not Docker is mostly performed in the root context when you use Docker, and Builder is getting performed in the user context, and that takes some more time in the build process.
Yeah, that's fine. you know, that you could always, you know, even 10 to 1, you know, it doesn't matter, right? Because the build process, you pay the cost once, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So, but just to highlight that there is a small impact, but yes, I would also say that the deployment of the containers in the large environment is a bigger problem, but there I haven't performed in analysis.
Yeah, I do remember when I was using code build in AWS, you know, the difference between an image with like 50 megs and 500 megs was actually, you know, 20 to 30 seconds, right? Load time, right? Which I thought Google could, you know, AWS could copy it faster, but I guess it depends how many hops and what's happening, how many times the things get copied, right? Because those things can get, you know, exponentially slower, right? The bigger the images are, right?
Yeah, that is actually the questions we had in the discussion I mentioned, because when there are files which are 1 gigabyte, for example, in temp, so you have a temp folder with X and that is 1 gigabyte size, does it really impact the starting of the container? Because that is just mounted here. So the load time, the initial load of that image is obviously smaller, but when it's on the node, does this affect the performance? I wouldn't be so sure.
Oh no, it will. It will, because the node has to copy the file over, right?
Yeah, once.
The first time.
So let us say it starts 10 images, 10 containers. That node needs to load the image once, but afterwards, I'm not sure if that is a mount, and that has no impact anymore.
Yeah, I'm interested to see the implications.
So that's why I'm not sure if there is really a performance issue when you have files which are not loaded. So when you load them in your startup in Java, then it will obviously have an impact. But when they're just there, I'm not so sure what happens after they are on that specific node.
Yeah, fair enough.
Okay. Yeah, we talked about that. So this is just a small reminder because we're now going over to JIP. So you have the build on the build server where you created a jar, and then you copy this jar into the runtime image, as we have seen. And an option is to use JIP in case you have a Java application. So it has the same advantage as distroless, because you can use JIP with distroless images. It claims to be simple. It claims to be fast. It claims to be creating reproducible builds. Reproducible means, as we have seen, you can create a bill of materials, and in case that always that it's the same, you don't need to recreate the whole image. You have a daemonless build like you have it with Builder, for example. So you don't need to have a daemon like with Docker. You can use JIP, for example, with Gradle. So you include it as a plugin in Gradle. You could also say what is your base image, then you define your target image here. It will automatically publish it when the build is successful, and then you call Gradle JIP and it does all the magic for you. So that is not very complicated for a developer. That is the alternative option when you. So the developer doesn't need to dig into a builder. It just does this and everything is working, and it can be a distress image here as a base. So it has different layers. So we saw here that there is a caching option. So it will JIP will cache classes, resources, dependencies, and so on. So when you recreate it an image, it might only take the classes and just update that. Then we have here the metadata, and you can see here the layer. So it will create multiple layers for all the classes, resources, dependencies, and so on, so that you have a faster deployment process. Then we talked about reproducible images. Reproducible means that there is no difference from one image to the next image. And that means that you also have to take into account the creation time here, because when that changes, the image has changed automatically, independent from if you have changed something else or not. So that's why they use the first of the Unix time, so 1970. So that might create complications, for example, for the cluster scanner, which I presented here last time, where I take into account the image build time from which is labeled on the image. So that's why I personally recommend to add here, when you use JIP, the container creation time and not use a reproducible image. But that is just in case you use a cluster scanner. In case you're not taking the lifetime of the image into account, then you might as well use reproducible images. Yeah, here we have the complete image lists in the end. You can see that when you use here, you can also use the Java version from Google as an option. And you see that this is already 195 megabytes. That is obviously because we have Java inside and that takes a lot of space. And the JIP version here with the base image we saw, which is not mentioned here, unfortunately, has 129 megabytes in the end, created with JIP. I think that will in the end use, I'm not sure. I can't say that out of the box. Yeah, you see that you can achieve different sizes. And from my point of view, size and files means more, as more you have, as bigger your text surface is. So let's come to a conclusion quickly. Distroless provides a text surface reduction and at least a rollout speed, maybe also a starting speed enhancement. Then Distroless requires more knowledge to build containers in case you use Builder. As a base image user, you need some knowledge, but with JIP, you don't need so much knowledge. You saw how easy it is to integrate a base image there to create a Java image. And Distroless, you have to take into account that it makes scanning for vulnerabilities in your operating system harder, but therefore you get the attack surface reduction. And as I said, I wouldn't take this so much into account because I think the baseline to have vulnerability scanning is to have a good patch and deployment process, and that is what you get here with the distroless, that there is only the things you need and nothing else. Do you have more questions?
Not for me. No, this is really cool. I really want to give this a good test drive.
Yeah, as you have seen, I have sometimes the references, right? So which you can.
Yeah, if you can see, then share the slide, we'll also put it on the presentation.
I couldn't figure it, find it right now, but you saw that it's sometimes there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I do feel that you almost want to start to have, you know, the flavors of distroless Node or distroless Nginx or distroless Alpine Python, right? You know, like, again, if I just want to run, you know, fast API, what do I need, right, to run that?
Yep, exactly.
That's actually really powerful. Cool. Well, any final questions? If we could get a chat. Oh, I think John was just saying, instead of a shell, you could share the PID and network namespace sidecar container, which has a shell. Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, that's correct. You could do that.
Yeah, it is interesting, the idea of using then a sidecar to, you know, for some of the debugging, right? Or some of the things that you might want to do that doesn't then require to change the mode, or I like the idea. Well, at least because we can recycle the pods quite effectively, I like the idea of having that really locked down version. And then, and if something starts to go wrong, you start to replace the pods, right, with the version that has more stuff. And then, unless the problem was caused by distroless, right, then you should be able to use that for debugging. I mean, so you only kick in those extra versions when needed.
Yep.
Cool. All right, man. There's no further questions. I think you should be able to stop the recording, right?
I should stop it. Okay.
Yeah.